we praise you, Jesus. My soul secure, your promise is sure. Oh, your love endures always.
Your time. Ushers, if you'll come on down, we'll receive the Wednesday night tithe and offerings. You know, it's been so long since I've done this, I don't know whether the children should go to the back now or later after the offering, which is, well, we just let them watch us give, amen? Teach them by example. Father God, bless this offering, I pray. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. In Jesus' name, amen. And then the children can go to the back. Do you know that old song called, Well, I've Been to the River and I've Been Baptized? I don't know the name of it.
Acapella.
Can you do it? If you know this one, sing it. Well, I've been to the river and I've been baptized. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. I've been changed from the creature that once I was and redeemed, and now my name. I've been changed. I've been newborn now. All my life has been rearranged. What a difference it made when the Lord came to stay in my heart. Oh, yes, I've been changed. Well, praise the Lord. All right. I'm going to just go ahead and take it from here. And if you hadn't sent your children, but I can tell you have. Okay. I got a special note here. To smile and to be kind. Wrote it myself. Nobody was getting on my case, especially Maddie. Maddie's in Atlanta tonight. I have this, I think it's spiritual insight. And that is that you can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth us. That's Philippians 4:19. I mean, that's a word, amen? And so when people say things to me like, well, you could do that, but I could never do that. You know, they may not use those exact words, but that's insinuated. And I have a tendency to get upset over that because I feel like it detracts from Jesus. It's almost like saying, you're special. You could do this, but me, I'm not special, so I can't. Listen, the only thing special is Jesus. I mean, we're all special in one sense of the word, but that means that we're all the same. That's not too special. I mean, it's special to God, but you know what I'm saying. And I'm reminded of the queen bee who eats the royal jelly. You know, that's the only difference between the queen bee and the worker bee is the food she eats. And the only one that gets that royal jelly is the queen bee and the larvae, the little babies. And to me, that's the most beautiful example of a Christian. The difference between us and the world is the food we eat. In Matthew 4:4 and Luke 4:4, Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God, that's rhema. If you look it up in the Greek, that's rhema. That's a revelation word. It's a specific word for a specific person in a specific situation. Now, you hear sometimes the evangelist will say, somebody has this problem, and 4 or 5 people will get healed. Well, which one really had it? Well, it didn't matter. It's the Holy Spirit's healing that problem right now, and it's a good time to get in. Amen? And so in a sense, you see, the word is for all of us, but the one that reaches out and takes a hold of it, to them it's rhema. It's not a mental thing, it's a spiritual thing. And faith, Romans 10:17, this is really important. I'm giving you something of real value here, even though you've heard it before. I listened to Paul Harvey today, and he said, repetition is good. I like that. And I can show you at least 5 places in the New Testament where it says that repetition is good. He said, I tell you these things even though you already know them and are established in the present truth. So when we hear things over and over, sometimes we just get a revelation of it that we didn't see before. So faith cometh by hearing and hearing. Are you still listening to me? Faith cometh by hearing and hearing. Faith does not come by having heard. Amen. Now, folks, when I heard, I was listening to a tape. This has probably been 30 years ago, but 87, I think it was 87. How long's that been? Pretty good while, anyway. Well, it was Fred Price was preaching at the Mabee Center out in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And he was at a minister's meeting, and he was preaching to the ministers, and he made that statement. That's the first time I'd ever heard anybody say that. He said, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing. Faith does not come by having heard. And he waited and paused. And after a few seconds, the whole crowd erupted because they got it. Now listen, you have to excuse me, but I spent about, 20-something minutes listening to Paul Hervey today. And I just love that guy. I used to listen to him all the time. He was a news commentator, probably the greatest that ever lived. But he made a statement that made me think when I said that that Fred Price paused. Paul Hervey said that he would pause. He said sometimes it's the pauses that carry the greatest effect. Yes. And he said some of his producers had threatened to save up all of his pauses and use them for advertisement purposes. Well, it was kind of funny because if you took all the pauses out, there wouldn't be a pause. The emphasis wouldn't be there, you know. But I know Brother Hagin said, you can go as much by what God doesn't say as by what he does say. Wow. Now, see, I found that in my life. I remember I did something. I don't even remember what it was. It's been years, years, years ago. But it's like I knew in my spirit that there was an angel standing over at the side, just kind of with his hands crossed and his head down. He didn't like what I just did or said. I don't remember what it was. But, you know, if you'll open yourself up, you can get real guidance by what's not said. Wow. Well, I have so much to say. I better get to it. I have, let's start with what I think is probably, if I went home and didn't do this, I'd feel real bad. Your faith can grow, okay? 1 Thessalonians 1:3 says your faith groweth, so our faith can grow. And if we feed it and we exercise it, it will grow. This is what I want to do at this moment. I want you to ask yourself something like, why am I in church tonight? What's my purpose? What's the point? What am I expecting to get out of this? Is this just a routine or am I really here to develop my spirit, you know? And so what I'm thinking about, now I know I'm a little all over the page right here on this, but you know that coronavirus. Well, the flu kills as many people usually as the coronavirus was doing, but now the coronavirus is catching up to the flu, and it's a serious thing. Yeah. It's like 2,000 people had, that was a day or two ago, I don't know how many now, but had died from it. Yeah. I think it was 46,000 that had been made sick by it or something. So, and one of the reasons people are in trouble is because they've gone to the doctor for every little thing, and he knew, you might not have known, but he knew he couldn't help you. So he prescribed antibiotics, and it killed off the good bacteria in people's intestines, and now they get sick with the littlest thing. It's almost, I guess, like the whole world's got AIDS, something like that. I'm no doctor, and if I get off in left field when I start talking about this stuff, take it with a grain of salt. But think about what I'm saying from my heart. The world's in serious trouble because now there's a new disease besides the coronavirus and besides the flu, and it's new, so they don't have a cure for it, and the whole world's in trouble, and you know what that means? The church is in trouble too. Because the church has never separated themselves from the world and trusted God. They're just as sick, just as bad, in just as much bondage as the world is. But they don't have to be. And I'm going to stop saying that. They. You don't have to be. That's right. You know, I heard Keith Moore say something that just really got me. And I know you've heard this. If you think I'm going to get up here and tell you stuff you haven't heard, you must think you're really dedicated, and so is the rest of them. But most Christians don't do what they already know. And so I come back and hit it again and again and again until at some point, hopefully, you'll say, wow, I see it now. So don't think that I have dementia of some kind. Pastor, every time you get in the pulpit, you cover that. Well, if you get it, now listen, I've been doing this for a long time now. And when you get it, I move on. Because I don't just follow notes. I might have notes. But my heart goes a certain direction. And when the Holy Spirit turns me, then I go that direction. And then I'll be repetitious on that. Because until you get it, I'm not for sale. I'm not up here to keep you happy so you'll keep coming back. And when I was a pastor here, or anywhere else for that matter, the less people that come back, the less I've got to do. Why should I burn the candle at both ends trying to help people that don't want help? Don't take that wrong. I love you. I'm here, aren't I? But you know, that's what I want to do. I want you to ask yourself, do you need healing? Because at some point, you're going to have to start believing God. And with all the sickness that's in the world, and there's more to come, have you heard about the locust problem? The locust, I watch the 700 Club. I tell you, if you're ever going to watch it, you better watch it, because Pat Robertson's like 89, and he's going to live forever, but not on this earth. And sometimes my wife gets frustrated, because I like to watch it every night when we go to bed. I put him on first. I want to catch the world news. I don't trust the media. I don't want to hear what they have to say unless it's coming through a Christian. So I like to hear what Pat Robertson says. And then I don't have to watch the whole program. I can skip through to whatever, or I don't. I don't have to skip through it. But Pat Robertson, he said, this is a biblical proportion. When these locusts come through, they are putting the world in jeopardy of famine. They're eating the crops so fast. They said, I don't have all the figures, but they're like 1.5 million in a small area. They come through and just eat up everything. This is serious stuff. Now, this is really new. This is different. This is different. This stuff is happening in biblical proportion. I'm telling you, the world doesn't know what to do, but you should. I'm going to give you a scripture, even if it hurts your feelings or makes you mad. Jeremiah 17:5. This is about the bramble bush. The bramble bush. Now, a bramble bush is what you see in cowboy days. It opens up on the street, you see all the dust and the horses tied up on the side, and along comes a bramble bush is blowing across the road. That's a bramble bush. All right. Thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, see, your arm of strength, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. He's more worldly, more carnal-minded than he is spiritual-minded. All right, look at verse 6. He shall be as the heath, that's the bramble bush. He shall be as the heath in the desert and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness in a salt land and not inhabited. That's the curse. But look at verse 7. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord and whose hope the Lord is. Cursed or blessed? Now I'm in a state of decision. I want to say to you, if you need healing, I want you to come up. I'm going to lay hands on you. We're going to deal with things, and I want you to come back next week and tell us how you're doing. You know, that's how personal I want it to be. But I don't do that very often. I'm not sure how that would work. So I'm going to keep talking just a little bit here. Let the fear settle.
I understand all that. I understand all that. Oh, no. There's my toothpick. I knew I'd forget it if I put it behind my ear, and I did. Don't tell Maddie. Oh, man. Well, I was driving in the car. And anyway.
I just texted Mom about your toothpick. She was like, oh, my God.
Do you remember, stay with me now because I'm gonna give you some scripture. You remember Romans 10, how do you get saved? How many Baptists we got? It used to be Baptists at least. That's not all. Woe is us. My goodness. If it wasn't for the Baptists, the Pentecostals wouldn't know anything. You know, all the Baptists got filled with the Holy Ghost and came over to the Pentecostal church and anyway. You get saved with your mouth. By believing and confession. So Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, or with the heart man believeth unto whatever it is you're praying for. But in this case, it was salvation. So for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the heart confession is made unto salvation. Now, that's sandwiched in between some things, and I want to talk to you about those things that sandwiched in between a little bit. Okay, let's go back to the last verse. I think it's verse 33. I don't think there's 34 verse of chapter 9, Romans 9, the last verse, 33, I think. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Now, if you look at different translations, one place it says, shall not be disappointed. Okay? And it says it in about four or five different places, of which I decided not to give you those scriptures and go to it because it takes a lot of time and it's a little bit redundant. But I just want to say to you right here that you will not be disappointed if you trust in Jesus. Now, if you trust in the doctors, if you trust in the banker, if you trust in your boss, if you trust in your wife or your husband, if you trust in the arm of flesh, you will be disappointed. Maybe not every time, but brother, it's coming. But if you trust in the Lord, you won't be disappointed. And if you're trusting in the Lord, you say, well, I trusted in the Lord and I was disappointed. Well, then you went about it wrong. See, in the midst of many counselors, there's safety. So before you make important decisions, you ought to talk to your care group leader, your pastor, somebody that's been saved longer than you, knows the word a little bit better, and say, I'm about to do such and such. Do you have any wisdom on that? Do you have any guidance? Save yourself some trouble. I can teach you on faith and I can get you out of the ditch, but I can also teach you on wisdom and keep you out of the ditch. So, that last verse, and then we're gonna go down. We just quoted Romans 10, 9 and 10. You know what verse 11 says? Let's do 11, since they're right here together. For the scripture says, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. There it is again. Will not be disappointed. You won't be disappointed. Now, let's go back and see what he's talking about. And for brevity's sake, I'm going to start with verse 6. And I'm going to paraphrase it. Well, I'll read it. All right. But the righteousness, which is the faith, speaketh on this wise. Now, he's talking here about how you get saved, how you become righteous. Okay? 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He became sin so we could become righteous. He became sick, Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, Matthew 8, 17, 1 Peter 2, 24. He became sick so we might become well, right? Well, y'all know these scriptures. I just wanted to remind you of them. It's not like the first time you've heard it. It's not like the 100th time you've heard it. Okay, and then here's one that you may have never heard before. 2 Corinthians 8, 9. For we know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, that through his poverty, ye might be rich. Now, see, I read the Bible lots of times, but I never caught that. No wonder the church has been lopsided. We got a three-legged table with two legs. And really, most of them aren't standing on the two legs. If you submit yourself to God and walk by the Spirit, you can rise above the problems of life. I'm not saying you won't have problems. I'm saying you can conquer them. Yeah. okay? And that includes sickness and disease, and it also includes poverty, because poverty is a curse. Okay, so let's go back to Romans 10:6. The righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say, not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ again from the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, near thee, close to you. It's in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. The word, faith and the word go together like wet and water go together. You can't have faith without the word. And when you get the word, that's when faith begins to come alive. Because faith begins, say that with me, please. Faith begins. Again, faith begins. Repetition one more time. Faith begins where the will of God is known. If you don't know the will of God, you might have hope, but you can't have faith. Because faith is, I know that, I know that, I know that, I know. It's a substance. It's the title deed. It's the $50 bill on the communion table. Forget that. $50 bill on your kitchen table. You know, don't associate it with the church, because the church isn't looking for money to get you healed or anything. I'm just saying, most Christians don't have $50 faith. They don't have $5 faith. Because they don't know what faith is. But faith says, I have it now. How do you know? I got it right here. Oh, I got a story I could tell you. I'm going to. And then you're going to bring me back to Deuteronomy chapter 30, and we're going to start with verse 11. Okay, that's when we get back. Not yet. How many know who Dr. Cho is? Dr. Cho pastors the world's largest church. He had like 1 million people in his church over in North Korea. He started off in about 1960, or actually it was in the 50s. And anyway, he got a revelation.
At South Korea.
South Korea, right. No, not north. And he got a revelation of the fourth dimension, the spirit world. And he began to see it. He could see it in the spirit. When he would pray, he would visualize it happening. And so he said, he got up and announced to the church that he had a bicycle desk and chair. See, he wanted a bicycle desk and chair. And he did his homework. See, people don't understand this. You know, like I told you the other day, I said, God told me, son, if you want that little car, go buy it. Not the one out there now. I just picked it up from the mechanic. That's the body man, actually. But a real cute little car. And he said, if you want that car, you can have it. But before he said that, I had done my homework all across America on the internet, and I knew what the cars were selling for and all like that. And that's why I was saying to the Lord, wow, Lord, it's only got 50,000 miles. It's the 2005. Wow. You know, this is a deal. I mean, I don't mean it's a no-brainer deal. I mean, they're hard to find. Yeah. The price was fair. Matter of fact, if you find a fair price for something that's hard to find, that's a good deal in my thinking. Yeah. And so I just said, you know, but I don't know. Maybe the church would think, you know. And then I got to thinking, you need to know that I've been a Christian for 50 years. Yeah. And if I'm not rich by now, something's wrong.
Yes, sir.
But you got to understand, I'm stable rich.
Yeah.
Because my foundation was based on obeying God and giving. Jesus. Not getting, not taking, but giving. And because I put myself back and put the kingdom first, to keep first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, all these things to be added unto you, not taken away.
Yes.
Matthew 6:33. And so because of that, my treasure, 6:19.
Yes.
Matthew 6:19-20. My treasures are in heaven.
Yes.
So my treasures are over there. What you see is just a little bit.
Yes.
The big stuff's already sent ahead.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. And what I found is when you're not surrendering your money, and that's Matthew 6:21,
And when you're not surrendering your money, you got a spiritual problem. You say, Brother Wayne, are you preaching on money? No, I'm preaching on health and healing, faith and healing. Because it's hard to get a miracle of any kind when you're self-centered. It's just hard. That's not the way to go. If you want to prosper and be successful, seek first the kingdom. Lay your life down. Bless others. Do for others. Don't be a taker. Be a giver. If you save your life, Jesus said at least 7 times in the New Testament, if you save your life, you will lose it. But if you lose your life for his sake, you'll find it unto eternal life. And what does a man profit if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? So Christians, remember Zacchaeus? He was a taker. But when he got saved, he said, half of my goods I give to the poor. Immediately became a giver. You've got to get free from yourself. So if you're not free from yourself, how are you going to really and truly be able to basically look God in the eye? Because when you're in faith, man, you're not intimidated by the devil or lack or anything else. When you're in faith, you come boldly under the throne of grace, Hebrews 4:16, and obtain help in time of need. Come boldly under the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We come boldly under the throne, not cocky. We come in and say, Abba, Father. Yes. I get off on this, don't I? Now, where was I going? Oh, thank you, Mandy. Yes, that's before I go to Deuteronomy. The bicycle desk and chair. So. Now, see, Dr. Cho, when he was talking about the bicycle desk and chair, and he wrote about this in his book, and he said, now, I didn't want just any bicycle. And he said, I don't know anything about bicycles. But he said, this bicycle from Germany, it's this way. And this bicycle from Japan, it's that way. And this bicycle like this, and this one's got that. And that, you know. He said, but the American bicycle's strong and sturdy, and that's what I want. He knew what he wanted. We need to be specific in our prayers.
Yeah, that's right.
He did his homework. He had confidence. I know exactly what I want. And then the desk, he said, I want a Philippine mahogany desk. And he said, not only that, I want a chair that has wheels on it so I can roll around like a big shot. You say, well, I don't know if I like that attitude. That sounds kind of prideful and everything. And well, hey, he got that stuff. Don't worry about it. God overlooked all that. See, we start looking for a crack somewhere. He said, I want a bicycle desk and chair. And God assured him it was his. But when he woke up in the morning, all of his faith leaked out. His words, not mine. And he went to the Lord and said, Lord, all my faith is gone. So he had to build himself up on his most holy faith. And then he decided in order to stay in faith, he's going to have to say it out loud to them and commit himself. So he stood up in front of his church and told them that God had given him a bicycle, desk, and chair. And everybody was so happy for him. But after service, there were 3 preachers that met him at the tent door and said, we want to see your bicycle, desk, and chair. Oh, he was scared. You know, he said, they're going to tell the church that I lied about all this. And so he said, well, follow me home. And so they're all walking home, and he's saying, oh, God, help me. And here's what the Lord showed him. And this is what he did. When they got to the house and they didn't see the bicycle desk and chair, they said, well, where is it? And he said, it's inside me. He said, it's growing in me just like a pregnant woman's baby is growing in her. And when the time is right, it will give birth. And you know, if I'm not mistaken, the way it went down, there was an American missionary that left and came back to America and gave him a bicycle, desk, and chair, exactly what he wanted. Every bit of it was just that way. How did I get off on that? You know, I learned from people who were successful in the Lord. Okay, so Deuteronomy. Remember, Dr. Cho got up and announced it to his church. Committed himself with his mouth. Okay, verse 11. For this commandment which I command thee this day is not hidden from thee. It's not hidden. It's not far off. Give me verse 12. Kick that thing. Those things run slow sometimes. It's not in heaven. I'm talking about the computer. It's not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall ascend up for us to heaven and bring it unto us that we may hear it and do it? 13. You kicked it too hard. Don't make me open my Bible. I'll start going into my footnotes and we'll be here all night. Neither is it beyond the sea that thou shouldest say, who shall go over the sea for us and bring it unto us that we may hear it and do it? See, it's not complicated. It's not difficult. Then what does he say? But the word is very nigh, very near, very nigh unto thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart, that thou mayest
do it.
Yeah. Pastor, why do you preach so simple? Use everything so simple. Because I want you to do it. James 1:22, be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own self. Go to 15. Deuteronomy 30:15. Yeah! See? That last one. That last one got my throat. See, I've set before thee this day life and good, and death and evil. Does that sound like a scripture you know out of Proverbs 18 or 21, 18, 21? Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Whoso findeth a wife findeth a good thing. I was talking to the Lord about that the other day. I was just thanking him for my wife. But here it is, 18, 21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Your speech, let's go back to Dr. Cho. Dr. Cho, this is many years ago. This is like probably 30 some odd years ago. Dr. Cho was having breakfast with a neurosurgeon. And the neurosurgeon was all excited. And he said, oh, Dr. Cho, we've had a medical breakthrough and it's so exciting. He said, I'm going to share it with you. He said, it's not even on paper yet. I mean, they haven't written it. It's not in a book. There's no article about it. This is hot off the grid. It is going to change the way we do medicine. And he said, we have discovered that the speech center controls all the nerves of the body. They found the source. And Dr. Cho's acting like Howard Carter. You know, when Howard Carter was real excited, he'd take his finger and do like this. And Dr. Cho just wasn't excited at all. And the neurosurgeon said, my goodness, man, this is a medical breakthrough. And Dr. Cho said, I already knew that. He said, how could you know it? This is just fresh discovery. We're all excited. This is world changing. And Dr. Cho said, I read it. I already knew it. I read it. He said, where? He said, in Dr. James's book. And the neurosurgeon said, who is this Dr. James? And he said, in the Bible, James 3:2 says, in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is the perfect man and able also to bridle the whole body. Now see, this is for senior high students, not freshmen. Because freshmen, they'll just run their mouth all the time. I know I've been guilty. You've been guilty. We've all been guilty. But when you find out the power that's in your mouth, you be careful what you say. And not just the negative side, because, you know, what you really have to do is work on your heart. That's why you need to pay your tithe. But never mind that. We won't go there right now. But see, if God's not in control of your money, he's not in control of your life. And that's an easy way to find out where you are, because your feelings are fickle. You can't tell where you are with your feelings, but you can with your checkbook. Yeah. You can see where you're putting your treasures, and that's where your heart is. Yeah. I get off on those things. What was I talking about before I got off on that?
Morning.
Okay. Okay. So Matthew 12:34 says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So whatever you're full of, you're not going to be able to stop it. There's no way around it. You are reaping today the fruits of the seeds you planted with your mouth from yesterday, etc., you know, last year and so forth. And so the seeds that you plant, I won't go there because that's another, I'm not preaching on that necessarily right now, but the thoughts that you think will come out your mouth. Okay, so those are the seeds that you plant. Once you say them, Brother Hagin put it this way, thoughts will come and thoughts may persist in staying, but thoughts not put into words die unborn. So if you don't speak them out, they just disappear. You won't even remember them after a while. But if you speak it out, you'll remember it later during the nighttime or during the day, and then you speak it again and again and again before you know it. It's coming out all the time, and then you're going to have the fruit of your lips. And so in verse 36 and 37, he says, by thy words thou shalt be, we'll have to give account of every idle word. And then by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. The Amplified says justified and acquitted, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned and sentenced. We're all going to stand before God and give account of every word, even the idle words. Your healing is in your mouth. You got a problem with anger? You get rid of it with your mouth. You don't love your wife? You get it with your mouth. You think I'm kidding, but I'm not. You mean I just say, well, before you say, you think. Because what you're thinking on is going to come out your mouth. So if you want to love your spouse, you begin to praise them inside of you. You begin to think good thoughts. You begin to become grateful. And you say things like to the Lord, thank you, Lord, for my spouse. Thank you, Lord. I sometimes include this. Thank you, Lord, that I'm not in prison. Thank you, Lord, that I'm not in hell. I tell you, you can become a happy Christian pretty quickly if you think right. I'm telling you, it's the truth. You know, you begin to thank God that you didn't reap what you were sowing. It makes life a lot better. And it's all in your mouth. You know what? Listen, John 6:63, Jesus said this. Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. You say, yeah, well, that's the words he spoke. Well, you speak his words then. Speak his words. Stop speaking yours and start speaking his. Because they're spirit and life, and they'll work for you. Amen. Now, we were over in Deuteronomy 30:15. And we should, let's go to Deuteronomy 30:15. I set before thee this day life and good, death and evil. And then what's 19 say? It says the same thing, I think. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life that both thou and thy seed may live. Now, I didn't give you the first few verses of Deuteronomy 30, and I skipped some in between verse 15 and 19, and then there's some after 19, just a few. And most of those scriptures are all saying, if you love the Lord with all your heart. And then one guy in the New Testament said to Jesus, what's the great commandment in the word? He said, to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your mind, all your strength, and all your soul. And the second's like unto it, to love your neighbor as yourself. So on these hang all the law and the prophets. Right here, Mark Lay, he worked with our youth for a period of time, about, I don't know. Everything seems to be revolving around the time 30, so we'll say 30 years ago. I don't know, a long time ago anyway. And he gave a testimony, and boy, I knew that was a word from God, and I've never forgotten it. He said, everything's going to burn except for your relationship with God and your relationship with people. Well, boy, that narrows it down. Now I know what to focus on. I know what to put my attention on. I know what my goals are. I know where I'm headed. I know where I've been, where I'm at, and where I'm going. And it has to do with loving God and loving people. And if you love, that means you put them first. Now, let me give you a good definition of love. I'm going to sandwich this in. I'm preaching about healing and I'm preaching about faith, but this is about love. So, what was I going to say? I got it. Love is the desire to benefit others at the expense of self. Because love desires to give. See, the greatest expression of giving of love is giving. When you really love somebody, you can't help yourself. You just want to give them everything. Lust is a desire to benefit self at the expense of others because lust desires to get. Let me give you a scripture you won't find in most churches today, and I did not say anything negative about anybody. How'd you like that? Wasn't that good? Thumbs up. It's in 1 John 2, 15, 16, and 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Ooh. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, all sins will come under one of those three, are not of the Father, but are of the world. And the world and the lust thereof passeth away, but he that doeth the will of the Father, the will of God, abides forever. If you're a taker, you're in trouble. What's the first thing I ought to do? Well, I don't know about the first, but tithing's in there real close to the first. Why is that so important? Because it comes before you do. Offerings come after you do. You wonder why when you approach God, you're not really getting what you're expecting to get, that warm welcome feeling. Now, maybe you do. Good for you. Praise God. You say, yeah, and I'm not a tither. Hang on. There'll come a day. Because it's all about honor. See, in Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, it says, honor the Lord with the first fruits of all thine increase, so shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses bring forth a new wine. God has to come first. That did you know that's required for being saved? Yeah, well, I did that. Excuse me, that's the door. 10th chapter of John, Jesus said, I am the door. You got to come through the door. You don't step in the door and come right back out. Think on that now.
There's a pause.
Yeah, there's a pause. See, when you surrender everything to the Lord, the devil has no place to get a handle on your life. It's James 4, 7. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. There's too many people say, I resisted and nothing happened. Yeah, well, you forgot the first part. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. When you submit yourself to God, the devil can't touch you. I mean, think about that just a minute. Think about that. What is water baptism all about? Chuck Missler, I was invited to a little dinner thing one time, lunch. And he was talking about how there are certain things in the Bible that you can't really support with Scripture. And he said, like, for example, and he looked at me and he said, where's the Bible talk about water baptism? I said, Romans 6, 1 through 7. And he goes, up. Well, that's right. And there's other, you know, like Mark 16, 15. But I love that man, Chuck Missler, great man of God. But you see, baptism is about your death. It's your identification with his death. What shall we say then? This is Romans 6:1. Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sins live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into his death? Are baptized into his death? Know ye not so many of us are baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into Christ, into death, like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. I guess it's been so long since I've done it. When you go down into the water of glade, remember, if we do it with dirt, you don't get up. The church would get smaller, not bigger. This is symbolic.
But don't let that throw you. Don't say, well, because it's symbolic, it's not important. It certainly is. It's all about what happened when you met Jesus. John 3:30. He must increase, you must decrease. Okay, so you planted together in the likeness of his death, so shall we be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Means if you're not planted together in the likeness of his death, you won't be in the likeness of his resurrection. So if you're looking for the curse to be removed, Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. He redeemed us from poverty, sickness, and spiritual death. And you're looking for that to be removed from you. But you weren't planted together in the likeness of his death, so you don't have any authority or any power. You're just like the sinner, but you're going to confess what all these teachers are telling you. Confess this and confess that. You doesn't matter at all. You know, I was reading a footnote in the Amplified Bible out of the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, and the print was so small I had to get a magnifying glass, but I had it all marked in green, powerful, and it said, to all these ages, it's always coming up with how you're not, my words, okay, I'm paraphrasing. You're not responsible for anything. Somebody else has done it all. But when you read the Bible, you found out you will be held accountable. Over and 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 over. You will be held accountable. How could there be a judgment if you're not held accountable? You say, well, I'm going to be rewarded. Okay. No problem from me. But some people won't. Anyway, I have so many things. I just finished reading Daniel, you know. Man, I could preach. There's a lot there. Daniel 12, too. But I won't go there. See, we have it all if we want it. But if you don't walk in Jesus' footsteps, it's not going to work for you. He blazes the trail, but we walk behind him. And his commandments are not grievous. Right. I looked that up the other day. Now, where is that? It's in 1 John. Is it 4:3? Just curious. Well, I guess not. Okay, let's go back. I got to wrap this up. Not that quick. Faith comes in two halves, in your mouth and in your heart. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Mark 11:23, you have what you say. James 3:2, and on down, the next following verses, your tongue is the steering wheel of your life. And Matthew 12, 36 and 37, will give account of every idle word. Our words are spirit and life, John 6:63. Don't minimize this. This is how you are supposed to live and receive good instead of evil. You say, well, I thought faith was the major thing. Hear me again now. Here's the point that I'm preaching on tonight. I'd like to review my notes, but I don't know if I can do it without and still keep going. All right, here, number one with faith. Has substance. It's real. It's you know that you know that you know. Number two, Jesus has done a finished work. It's already done. You don't have to ask him to do what he's already done. Yeah. Right. And don't ask him to do what he told you to do either. Right. Number three, faith comes in two halves. In your mouth and in your heart. Two halves. Not just in your heart, but in your heart and in your mouth. There's a sword in your mouth. Yes. Your words are spirit and life. Yes. Or they're spirit and death. Hopefully there'll be more spirit and life than there are spirit and death, but the ability to speak both resides in you. Yeah. And you have what you say. So if you don't like what you've been picking, you need to change what you've been planting. And that goes with all of us. That goes with all of us because, you know, I don't think any of us really claim to be completely perfect as far as perfection. Paul said, what was it in Philippians 3:10 or something? He said, not as though I were already perfect, maybe it's verse 12, but not as though I was already perfect. We're not perfect like without flaw, but we can be perfect like mature.
Our heart can be perfect towards God. And when we miss it, we can say we're sorry, and we can teach our children to do likewise. Those are the important things. Love God. And love people. And go ahead and put God ahead of yourself. Here we go again. Tighten your seatbelt. Keith Moore says, what does seek ye first the kingdom of God mean? He said, it means if the church needs carpet and you need carpet, who gets the carpet? I thought, he just makes it so simple, doesn't he? Why does he do that? Because he wants you to do it. I'll tell you what, you can really be free from covetousness if you pay your tithe and give offerings. Remember Malachi 3:10 talks about offerings too. And then support missions. And then give alms. If you see your brother have need, shut up your bowels of compassion from him. How dwells the love of God in you? If you see somebody without shoes and you got a bunch of shoes, you ought to help them. Well, maybe you ought to help them. Maybe you ought not to. Maybe they sold the last few pairs that people gave them. I don't know. Take time to get to know people. You have a ministry. And when you lay hands on the sick, something will happen. Listen, I probably ought to... Oh, it's too early to quit. Ed Sell. Huh? Is it nine?
Nice.
Oh, my good friend Ed Sell, he's going to be with Jesus about 6 years ago now, a little over. He had a guy come down here. I told you this the other day, but somebody that's here tonight wasn't here then, so I'll tell it now. But this guy was coming down to, Ed was the highest ranking non-Oriental in the world in Taekwondo. And so this guy was coming down to get his master's degree in Taekwondo. It was his fifth degree. But he had had a problem, and his mind, he couldn't remember short term. His short term memory was gone. He had to have a teenager stay with him all the time because he couldn't remember what had just happened. And Ed told him, come down here and let Pastor Wayne pray for you. And so they rented the top floor or something of the Swan Hotel down there on South Florida Avenue, and so all these people from all over the place were there. And Ed introduced me to him, and I began to talk to him, and I said, okay, I'm going to pray for you. And I laid my hands on his head, and I said, now I want you just to close your eyes and see yourself well. And it was like laying your hands on a stump or a doorknob. It was just nothing, nothing receptive. And so I said, now I want you to get a picture of yourself well. Now, he's into karate and everything. He had five schools himself that he was about to lose because he couldn't function. And so I said, see yourself, you know, testing or something. See yourself doing what you do. And I said, can you see that? And he said, yes, I can see that. I said, now hold that picture. See it very clearly. I said, get it in living color. See an action shot. I said, now can you see that? And he said, I can see that. And I said, Holy Spirit, make it just like that. And the anointing was flowing. And then all of a sudden it stopped. And I said, now what did you do? He didn't even answer, I don't think. He didn't know what I was talking about. What did he do? He's just standing there, hadn't done anything. But he stopped the anointing. I said, now the anointing was flowing into you and it stopped. I said, you got your mind off of the picture, didn't you? He said, I did. He wrote a book. I got it in my office. So when every time Pastor Wayne said, the anointing stopped, he said, it did. I knew it did. And he said, every time he said, there it is again, he said, I could sense it. It was there. And that happened several different times. I had to work with him to get his mind quiet. Mm-hmm. Now, I can do that with you. I can help you. I can't heal you, but I can help you. I can help you get your mind out of the way. You know, personal testimony, one of the things I have done to help me get my healing is turn my mind off. It wasn't trying necessarily to believe God or muster up faith or anything. I'm not saying that you shouldn't. You certainly ought to have faith, and you certainly ought to do all you can. But when your mind begins to enter into the picture and unbelief begins, do you know what unbelief is? It's like a spirit. Unbelief, I think I could say this if you don't hold me accountable to it, but unbelief is a spirit. Unbelief sides against the word. It takes sides against God's word. Okay? Unbelief always takes sides against God's word. And here it is. Numbers 13:32. You remember when Moses sent the spies into the land of Canaan? And they came back and they said, they brought an evil report. God calls it an evil report. And he says, of the land which they searched unto the children of Israel, saying, the land through which we have gone to search it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants thereof, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. And they go and start discussing the problems. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which come of the giants. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers, and so we were in their sight. They're just talking the problem. What do you think God thought about that? What if you were one of the 10? See, he sent 12, but Caleb and Joshua, they had a good report. They said, it's a piece of cake. We just came through the Red Sea and all these things and Jordan River, and it's a piece of cake. He said, it's cake to us. Isn't that what he said? Bread to us. Saying, we today would say it's a piece of cake. What did God think about? What if you were there? What if you took your little sword? Maybe your granddaddy made your sword. You know, maybe you got it for Christmas when you turned 12. I don't know. But it's your trusty little weapon. But when you looked at a guy that's like 12, 14 feet tall, and you looked at your weapon, you turned and ran. And God said, I don't like it. And you said, well, I don't care. I'm not going to go. Listen. I'm going to do this because you don't hear this other places. I don't believe you do. I don't believe you do. If you do, you can tell me after church. But you know, Revelation 21:8 says the first one on hell's roll call is the cowardly. It says in the King James, but the fearful and unbelieving and abominable whoremongers, adulterers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth fire and brimstone, which is second death. But other translations, and if you look it up in the Greek, that word is cowardly. Oh, man, I get tired just listening to myself preach. It's pretty heavy, isn't it? You got to work through this. Fear is a spirit. The spirit of fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love. Perfect love casts out fear. 1 John 4:18. And what was it, 2 Timothy 1, 7? Okay, so let's see what God thought about it. Put yourself in the position. You got your little trusty dagger, and here's a guy 14 feet tall, and you're scared. Okay, let's go to Numbers 14, 36, and 37. And the men which Moses sent to search the land, who returned and made all the congregation to murmur against him by bringing up a slander upon the land. And 37, even those men that did bring up the evil report upon the land died by the plague before the Lord. God judged them. Now, what am I saying? I'm saying you better learn how to believe God for a headache, for some small thing, and stop running to the doctor or the medicine cabinet. Did you know that Revelation 18:23 says that the whole world was deceived through pharmakia? Deceived the whole world through drugs. Somebody says, well, I got a prescription. Stop it. You sound stupid. You sound stupid. Stupid. Just because you have a prescription doesn't mean it's okay. What if you signed a contract as a hitman? I got a paper. I got a contract by a professional. We really need to start trusting God. Start in the small things. Baby steps. Baby steps. Baby steps. Start where?
Baby steps.
No. There's an... No. Start where you are. Start where you are. You can't start where you aren't. And you can't always wait for some other time. Now's the time. Today's the day. Now's the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. You can confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, and thou shalt be saved. Sozo. Preserved. Healed. Delivered. Find safety and soundness. It's a finished work. It's already done. Already done. Colossians 1:13 says, He hath, past tense, delivered us from the power of darkness. If it came from the devil, you're delivered from it. Now, I told Jonathan yesterday, I said, I am going to just get up and tell stories tonight.
You told one, Dr. Chip.
Yeah, I did. I did tell one, but that wasn't in my notes. So I don't have time to tell you any stories now. Think you could come back next Wednesday?
Yeah.
Think so? I want to tell you, I'm so grateful that God's word is true. I don't hardly know what to do. I'm so happy about that. You say, yeah, but it's got all this harsh stuff in it. You can read. You can see it. Don't go there. Stay out of the ditch. Just be obedient. Well, it's so hard. He said his commandments are not grievous. You can do this. Hello, Brother Wayne. With your mouth. With your mouth. Think good thoughts about your spouse particularly, but with your mouth, it's the steering wheel of your life. And if you don't take sides against the word, I don't care how ridiculous it seems. Jesus said in John 14:12, verily, verily, I say to thee, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. You can do what Jesus did because he did it under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. He didn't do it because he was the Son of God. You're Son of God too. Now, you can do it under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. We can fix this problem. We can rise up and not get sick. When everybody else is getting sick, we'll be laying hands on them and believing God. Father, help us get the revelation of your word deep within our heart. Tonight, as we go home and go to sleep, help us to see in our mind's eye all the good things that you have for us, and all the good things that you've done for us, and help us to purposely be grateful and to enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise, to be thankful unto you and to bless your name in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Good night, and God bless you.